it is proverbially said that if there were no God, man would have created one. Thank God, there is God. Man doesn't have to create. It means there is no human society ever known to us anywhere in the world that does not believe in some superhuman power or the other. And tribals are no exception. Tribals have their own religious beliefs and practices and cultural traditions built around their beliefs and practices. We shall now look into the types of religion practiced by the tribal people in India. Foremost, simple supernaturalism. That means anything that is supernatural, anything that is superhuman is something to be propitiated, something to be worshipped. Animatism. Animatism basically believes in the soul. There is some soul which makes the human being alive. When the soul goes out of the body, human being is declared dead. In fact, there are tribals who believe in minimum two souls in the human body. One is the life soul, another is the ancestral soul. There is a very interesting interpretation based on this. Life soul is what makes a human being alive. Ancestor soul is what is responsible for the continuation of the tradition. This probably explains why many of us dream dead ancestors in our dreams when we sleep through the night. That's because of the ancestor soul which goes out to meet the dead ancestors when we are sleeping. Naturism, there is part of nature or the whole nature itself is God or goddess, depending on what the tribal community believes, whether it believes in female form or the male form. Manaism. Mana is a very interesting concept of the tribal people. Human beings had to explain, when all human beings live together and every human being is living the same kind of life, eating the same kind of food, living the same style of life, why some people are more powerful, more effective, more energetic than the others? They believed in mana. Suppose there is a tree. You are planting the trees like all the other saplings, but certain trees bear better results. They bear more fruits. Why? That's because there is mana. If some human being is more powerful than the others, that's because there is mana. There is a certain additional extra power that is available in the body of the person or in the particular item of nature which makes it more powerful. Bongaism. Bongaism, Bonga is the sun god of the Mundas. Of course, solar people, people who worship the solar power is nothing unknown to the world, nothing unknown to Hindus in particular. So, Bonga is what is believed by the Mundas as their sun god whom they worship. Similarly, Santas believe in Thakurji. Thakurji is a very famous supreme deity for the Santals. Maranburu, the great mountain. Buru actually means the great mountain. Great mountain is the one who takes care of the community, takes care of the tribal people. And the consort of Maranburu, the great mountain, is Jahir Iwa, the lady of the grove, who takes care of their environs, takes care of their flora and fauna. Nagas have an earthquake god. For everything that happens in Naga life, their earthquake god is the most important and powerful. Similarly, Kashipunars have a practice of religion very well known. There are no temples, but they are a very religious people. Just imagine you and I living in the Hindu society without a temple, either at home or in the community. It's hard to believe, but Kashipunars are a highly religious community managing their religious worships and rituals without a temple. Birhor religion. Birhor people always believe in haunting spirits. They are afraid of haunting spirits. That means any time they happen to do something dishonest and unfaithful and untruthful, they are worried about a certain spirit which will go into the hiding and haunt them all their lives. Besides the practice of religion by the people, we need to know, especially after the arrival of the religious people from the West, conversion into Christianity that took place. So religious conversion among the tribals has been very predominant, particularly in the Northeast. The most ready examples are the Nagas, who are today the most Christianized, most Western educated, so much so. We had very recently a person from the Naga tribes as the speaker of our parliament. Karyas of Birhor similarly are also a Christianized lot. Similarly, West Bengal Santals have also undergone Christian conversion. But besides all these practices, there are cultural traditions. The best occasion to see the cultural tradition of a particular tribe is to arrive there in the middle of the tribe when their annual festival is going on. You will see the entire social organization coming into play. People playing different roles in the organization of their annual festival, and the role of language, the practice of rituals and the festivals. Rituals stimulate natural processes. Now, there is a very interesting practice among certain tribes in the northeastern communities. There, they believe that when it rains, normally rain is preceded by lot of sound of the thunder. But they do not know where the thunder arises, where the thunder prevails. But all they know is there is a big noise that precedes the rain. So, therefore, believe that if a big noise is produced, there will be rains. So, when there is a paucity of rain, what they do? They go in great numbers on top of the mountains. Depending on their own ability, they will choose big rocks and boulders and they roll them down the mountain top. And as the rock rolls down the mountain top, a lot of noise produced, and they believe rain follows this noise. Rituals of hunting before expedition is very important among the people who are hunters. That is, before they go on a hunting expedition, they all come together and perform a ritual where whatever they want to hunt is produced in their models there in the rituals, and they produce the effect of hunting the particular animal, and they believe it will have a magical effect and their hunting expedition will be successful. Agricultural festivals before plowing, before transplantation, before harvesting, nothing much needs to be told. We have seen it all in our rural India. We have analyzed the tribal religion so far, but in more recent times, there has been a strong influence of Hindu religion and Hindu pantheon among the tribal gods and goddesses. Not always it is the choice of the tribals themselves. Sometimes it is because of the influence of the Hindu neighborhood, but also because tribals today have not been able to avoid interaction with the non-tribal people around in their everyday life. So the intercommunication between the tribals and non-tribals has been strong enough. Particularly after India became independent and all these tribal areas were under some name or the other made part of the Indian constitution, made part of the Indian country. Therefore, the interaction between tribals and non-tribals has increased manifold compared to the British times and pre-British times. So, tribals have come under the influence of Hindu religion. In fact, anthropologists use a very interesting term. When Hindus come across the tribal people and experience the kind of religion they have and the kind of gods and goddesses they have, they become interested in some of the practices that the tribals have been successfully following over the generations. Thus, like for instance, the Gonda gods and goddesses have become famous, and in fact, in central India, part of the Hindu neighborhood have also adopted some of them. In fact, if you take the example of the Sabari movement, for instance, many years ago, not more than about 50 years ago, Sabarimala was a small hill temple in Kerala. Not many people knew about Ayyappa God. Now, Ayyappa God has become universalized, not only inside India, even outside India. So, anthropologists use the word universalization. That is, a god or goddess or a practice which was limited to a certain region getting enlarged and covering more and more parts of the surrounding areas. The opposite of universalization is parochialization. Now, the gods and goddesses of the tribal areas, having come across the influence of the Hindu religion, the pantheon, the gods and goddesses, now the god of the tribal people is identified with the Hindu pantheon. So the god becomes a Shiva, god becomes an incarnation of Shiva, the goddess becomes the incarnation of Parvati or Shakti, or the god becomes an incarnation of Jagannath or Vishnu, goddess becomes an incarnation of Lakshmi, etc. And of course, the tribal people have all been well known for worshipping a rain god, but now their rain god is falling in line with the Varuna of the Hindu pantheon. Similarly, Lakshmi Puja is not uncommon among the tribal people who are living in the neighborhood of the people in the non-tribal areas where Vishnu worship and Lakshmi worship are rampant. If you see the tribal cultural festivals, there are colorful dances with costumes. The most notable one among these is the Manipuri dance. Having come under the influence of Vaishnavism, Manipuri dance is nothing other than the Rasalila of Lord Krishna of the Hindu mythology. Most songs are tuned, however, to natural processes and call for bounty. Many rituals of the tribal people, they look like the religious ones, but actually they are so pragmatic. They are always praying for prosperity, for bounty, for good rains, good crops, good prosperity of the animal that they are depending on. Among tribals in general, everyone is a musician and a dancer, and the best time to see it is when they are having their annual festivals. Almost every little boy, teenage boy or a girl, every adult, man and woman is equally conversant with the music and dance which is unique for the particular tribe. The beautiful wall paintings, decorations and crafts also depict the various aspects of the rich and colorful life of tribal people. And most of these wall paintings, decorations and crafts also have something to do with the religion of the tribal people. Wall paintings may depict a scene in a particular folk tale or folklore of the tribal people. The decorations made may also indicate their religious beliefs and practices. Embroidery work, for which kadabas and kont women are certainly well known among the tribal people in India, their embroidery work is so beautiful, so attractive, so impactful and so intricate, but many of them do indicate their religious beliefs and practices. Bead and lacquer ornaments, about which we already talked about, bills, the bill women, how bedecked they could be in their lacquer-based bead ornamentation, how completely dressed they could be in this ornamentation, we have already noted it in an earlier lecture. Headbands with decoration for dancing, the most dominant, ready example is the bison horn Moriya dance among the people in Bastar. Wood carvings, clay figures, earlier we noted that every tribal group is very much adept in making imaginative clay figures and other kinds of handicrafts. In fact, some of the tribes in the central belt of India are known for wood carvings. In fact, it's hard to believe with their limited technology and limited tools that they are able to produce such beautiful wood carvings in the central belt tribal people. Similarly, clay figures and some of them even using the smelting of metals make metal figurines by using different metals. All these depict the various practices and beliefs that the people have. Tribal people have undergone certainly changes like this due to the influence of the non-tribal people, whether they are Hindus or even Muslims, for instance. But closer to the civilized world, there is less control now on their tradition. Now more and more tribal people are coming under stronger influence of the non-tribal practices and the non-tribal beliefs, non-tribal religious rituals. Hunters and gatherers, for instance, are most particularly vulnerable because government-organized settlements are typically larger than natural. hunters and gatherers, we have earlier noted that they have been limited to a particular area. They are not very much exposed to the wider world. But after the racist legislations about tribal areas, which all became government parts of the state, government organized various settlements, especially forest tribes of the hunters, for instance, who were moved out, evicted from the forest. They were rehabilitated elsewhere. They came across the people to whom they had not been exposed. In fact, the joke about the tribals is an average tribal shies away, particularly the tribal women shy away from the very look of the non-tribal people. They do not want to have any interactions with the non-tribal people, but government organized settlements are typically much, much larger than their natural habitats, whether it is within the forest or within the plain area where they have been living. Now, settlements of gatherers and herders, you have seen, is now much, much wider, and their world is much bigger, more complicated. They are not able to understand even why only deal with it. Now, we must note the role of the missionaries in tribal change. In fact, right from the pre-British times, there has been the influence of missionaries. Missionaries who actually came to India to spread the message of Christ as the Prince of Peace, to message to the tribal people the role of love in everyday life and how people could live more comfortably through the exhibition of love towards each other. They can lead an amicable life, but yet there was conversion into Christianity through their efforts. And many average missionaries were very smart in choosing two important aspects of tribal problems, one poverty and another sickness. In fact, tribal people, when they are sick, many of them do not even know that they are sick, because tribal people have always lived accepting the nature, not rebelling against nature. So sickness is also not seen as sickness. This is part of life. You would be surprised to note that many tribal people would not even realize that they are poor, partly because their world is small, they have a contented life, they have limited wants, and poverty is basically something very relative. Only when you compare your own way of life and the standard of living with somebody else, you know whether you are rich or poor. So tribal people lived within their own world, and even if they were considered poor by the people who were coming from outside, tribal themselves did not realize that they were poor. But however, missionaries got into these two declared as the important problems. They tried out helping the tribal people in overcoming their poverty, to bring them to better standards of living, similarly cure them of some vital diseases they were dying of without even knowing that it is a disease that they are dying about. Similarly, with all these efforts, they were able to convince the tribal people as their own saviors, and therefore they were able to take them into confidence, and in course of time they could convert them into Christianity. We have learnt about the various religious practices and beliefs of the tribal people with particular reference to India. We have understood the wide variety of religious practices that the people have. But what is very common for all the practices is the basic belief in a certain superhuman, supernatural, all-powerful force that is always there in the background, trying to help the human beings live a better life. That is, so long as they are propitiating these powers. So it is the human effort all the time to keep the superhuman powers happy and comfortable, and sort of convince them that they are not being taken for granted, so that these superhuman powers bestow on the human community a better prosperity and a better, more comfortable life. We have also understood in the course of this lecture how tribals have not remained the same. They have undergone changes, whether it is their own choice or the changes have been imposed on them, like the government of India or the state government programs after independent India, or the work of the missionaries pre-British, through British times, and even after that, bringing about changes in tribal life. Today, tribals are in transition. They cannot anymore live in isolation the way they have lived over the generations.